What's up, everyone? It's me, Mario. So right now, as I'm recording this video, it is December 20th. Now, if my voice starts acting up in a random way, it's because I'm a little sick, so you know I got all that nice stuff going on there. But I want to make a little ranting video, I guess. We're almost at the end of the year, and it's no secret that it seems like this generation of systems is nearing its last one, maybe 2 year life cycle. That's it. So I kind of want to go on a little rant. And honestly, this has been my opinion for a while. But I want to explain why I think this generation of systems sucks. Now, if you all have seen my video, I did a little documentary last year. Technically, it was this year, but it was when I was a senior in high school. And it was about just gaming in general and this generation and all that. Now, it was about the game industry. The game industry has never been better. They are making record numbers, okay? The recession, any of that, that hasn't stopped anything. People are still cranking out real good games. People are just eating up that $60 a game. But I just think the games that are coming out, how they're being executed, how they're being made, and the systems, I think they all suck. And now the numbers might, you know, differ from my opinion. Because you might start bringing up numbers like, oh yeah, well, the Wii sold this many, or Skyrim sold like 10 million copies already. Yes, that is true. And Skyrim's actually a pretty good game that deserved to get Game of the Year. But it's one of the gems out there, one of the few. So first, I want to talk about the actual systems. Now, it's no secret that I like the Xbox a lot. I'm not sure if I would consider myself a fanboy, and I really don't consider myself one, just due to the fact that how can I be a fanboy if I own every system this generation? At least the main ones, of course. I have a PS3, I have a Wii, and right now I have 8 360s. Eight of them, yes. I actually had 9 a few days ago, and one of them, so I'm going to go down to 7, actually, because I'm selling off one to a buddy of mine. And then one of my systems, it was red-ringed, which I actually got a good deal on there, because I bought it for $20. It had a good drive. I took the drive out of it, swapped it out with another one. I tried fixing up a little bit, but it was a real bitchy error code, and it brought up like 5 of them. And I ended up turning around and selling it for $30. So I got a good drive, and I got my money back and some profit, so it was a good deal for me, at least. But yeah, I have to say, I really was about to say the 360 might be the worst system, but I don't know. Because here's the thing. In short, this is what I'll say. The Wii has some good games on it. However, it is a current generation system with last generation's graphics. They're going to be cranking out the Wii U pretty soon, so it really didn't last too long. And honestly, there are good games on the Wii. There really are. But there's just so much shit on the Wii that you have to sort through to get to the good games. Like, you know, some people might be saying, oh, well, there's Smash Bros., there's Super Mario Galaxy, there's Mario Kart. But have you seen all the shit? Like, the pure shit that is on the Wii shelves? Like, that the good games make up a small minority of what is on store shelves. It's pretty sad. The PS3... You know, I like it, but honestly, it's just not the gaming system for me. Now, there are people that I know of, they love playing on the PS3. They say it's a superior system. It has Blu-ray, which I like the Blu-ray, but honestly, I bought it for a Blu-ray player. I needed a Blu-ray player that could also play all of my HD movies. Like, you know, my Xvid rips and everything. So, I want a Blu-ray player with a hard drive. PS3 satisfies that pretty well. I have some games on it, but I mean, I don't play anything on it. And my main drawback on the PS3 is that, okay, I have a pretty good internet connection. Any given day, I can download at least 2-3 megabytes per second. There was one time about a year ago, I wanted to play Mod Nation Racers online. Well, not even online, I just want to do single player, but I want to download the updates, you know? And the problem is, on the PS3, the updates are so damn big. Which isn't really that big of an issue, because I have a 250GB hard drive installed in there. But the thing is, the updates are just so unbearably slow. And like I said, there's nothing wrong with my internet connection. There's nothing wrong with where the PS3 sits. My laptop pretty much sits in the same spot, and I'm pretty sure I'm downloading stuff on there at like 2 megabytes a second right now as I'm talking. But it took me 3 hours. 3 hours to download updates for Mod Nation. At the end of the 3 hours, when the game was fully updated, I didn't even want to play it anymore. It's bad. It really is. And I've talked to many other PS3 owners that have the same issues. It's just the updates, and they're big for updates, but they're not that big compared to 2011 standards. It's like maybe a gigabyte and a half for an update. That shouldn't take that long. Like, a few months ago, I was over at a LAN party, and I was downloading, it was PC, I was downloading Team Fortress 2 onto my laptop. It was like a 10GB file, alright? It took like, at most, an hour and a half to download. That's it! That was 10GB! The update for Mod Nation was no more than 2, and it took me twice that amount. On a system that's supposed to be superior to the other ones. So, that's my issue with PS3, really. And actually, another thing, one of my friends just told me about this. Now, this might not be with the PS3 specifically. I don't know. But it's more maybe a game thing, really. One of my friends called me up last night, and we were talking about it on Facebook. And, like, he talked about it, he put up on a status, I commented on it, and then he called me up, and he's like, hey, well, I know you kind of know about this stuff, so could you help me out? Pretty much this is what happened, okay? He's playing on PS3. He's playing Call of Duty Modern Warfare, the first one. And he just goes into a public hacked lobby. He's not doing anything in there. His system's completely legit, not modded or anything. He doesn't have any hacks. But for some reason, he got blacklisted as a modder. And he got blacklisted off of Modern Warfare servers. What the fuck's up with that? And honestly, I hadn't really heard of that issue on Xbox, but that was the first time I've heard about it on PS3. And he said that he had heard about several other people, this same thing happening to them. At least on the Xbox, I don't know, like the live enforcement team, they're doing a better job, alright? They actually look at those reports. If you file system tampering on someone, they're going to look into that, and they're going to see what that kid has been doing. And PS3, I don't know if this was a fluke, or if this is actually going on, but... And this might not even be PS3, it might just be Infinity Ward. But that's a pretty bad way to handle this situation if you're going to be banning completely innocent players off of your servers. It's just my take on it. I think that's the right take. Now, going into the actual systems themselves, well, now... Finally, I have the Xbox to talk about. Ooh, what can I say about the Xbox? You know, it is my favorite system of this generation. But it has so many issues. So many. Now, there's going to be people who are watching this, and they're laughing. They're like, yeah, you guys got the red rings. If you move your system, you get a nice little circular scratch on your disc. That. We know. We know that. We know, okay? We've known this since 2005. There's no need to clarify it. Now, this one person that I subscribe to on YouTube, his name's Zaren Isaac. I was watching a HD rant that he did before. And at one point he was talking about the 360. And he brought up something that I had never thought of. He said, of course, we all know, the 360 was rushed, okay? The original Xbox, its lifespan was 4 years. 4 years. And by that, I mean, it came out in 2001, and then in 2005, they released a successor to it. Alright? And the way they were treating the Xbox, I mean, yeah, they had the original Xbox Live up for a few more years after that, but they just didn't really care. And the reason why they killed off the original Xbox so early was because, really, Microsoft was losing money on that. I read an article about this years ago, but they were losing a good amount of money on that system. They needed something that could get them out of the hole pretty quick. I think it just got them into the hole deeper. So they released the 360 in 2005. And mind you, Microsoft is still pretty new to this console game. Because the Xbox was Microsoft's first console. Correct me if I'm wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. Because there might be a little system out there that Microsoft made that I don't know about. I don't know. So then they bring in the 360. And they rush it. There's many units that come out that are dead on arrival. It only had, if I remember right, I think it had a 3-month warranty. There are many systems that failed before that warranty. Pretty much all the systems failed after the warranty. And it was just, they had so many issues with it. And now I could make a whole video about the 360's hardware issues. But I'm not going to. I mean, in short, it had the red rings, and there's like 200 reasons why you could get a red ring of death. It had the E airs, which is just one red light. It had the Christmas light airs. The disc drives, you pay $60 for a disc, and you tap your Xbox, and you get a nice circular scratch on it. And actually, the disc drive, that wouldn't even been that much of an issue. Because he had professional people making these. Now, when the system first came out, it had Hitachi drives, and it had Samsung drives. Now, Llama.com did a comparison on these drives. They actually fixed the circular scratch issue on a few drives. The issue is that there are, like, some little buffers on DVD drives for computers. There's little buffers that prevent everything from, like, moving around and scratching. And those buffers are not on the 360's drives for whatever reason. I don't know why, but the companies didn't put them there. And this even affects the Slims. The people with Hitachis and Lidons on Slims. Even when you get the Slim, when you open it, like, brand new, there's a sticker on there that says, do not move the system while it's playing, or it says something like that. Pretty much tells you, if the disc is spinning, don't move the fucking system. But anyways, getting back to Zarin Isaac, he made a good point. He said, Microsoft kind of ruined next-gen systems. Which would be this gen now. The reason why is because they rushed out the 360. And as he said, now I'm paraphrasing what he said, they rushed out the 360. At the time, there was a format war between HD DVD and Blu-ray. Blu-ray is the obvious winner. But this was a year before the Wii and the PS3 came out. This is when HD was still relatively new. So, instead of going, you know, download only, Microsoft had to pick an optical media to use. Now, they couldn't use Blu-ray, because that was Sony's thing. And they couldn't use HD DVD, because that was still being made. So what do? They use dual-layer DVDs. You know who else used dual-layer DVDs? The Xbox and the PlayStation 2. So you have a next-generation system using the same media as it did on the previous generation systems. You don't have as much space physically on the disc as you do on a Blu-ray or so. A single-layer Blu-ray is 25 gigabytes. A dual-layer DVD is about 8 gigabytes. So, what does this mean, really? Now, the Wii, I'm not going to include that, because that also uses DVDs, and the games are coded completely different on there. A game coded on the Wii is not the same as a game coded on the 360. But that pretty much means that games that are supposed to come out both for the PS3 and the 360 have to be coded the same. Now, I honestly think that HD-DVD, yes, it was a failed format, but it would not have been as much of a failure if the 360 came out with a built-in HD-DVD player. And not just for movies. I'm talking about for games. Because at least on HD-DVDs, a single-layer HD-DVD is 15 gigabytes. A dual-layer one is 30 gigabytes. You have more space to work with. I mean, still, the Blu-ray is going to be superior, of course, and the Blu-ray is still going on. But really, I mean, all these games that are coded for the 360 and all the other systems, they have to be coded specifically to match the 360. So you're going to have, like, for one of my good examples would be Marvel vs. Capcom 3. It's less than 4 gigabytes on each system, on the PS3 and the 360. The PS3, recently I saw Uncharted 3, that game was 45 gigabytes. Because they actually embraced the disc format. They were able to fully utilize Blu-ray. While as if you're a developer and you're trying to fully utilize Blu-ray, it's pretty much a given, I'm going to be honest. The money is in the 360 because more people have that. More spoiled 12-year-olds who play Call of Duty have 360s compared to PS3s. But the 360 isn't as good when it comes to disk space and all that. So you're going to have to code your game the same way. And what I was saying about the HD-DVD is that Microsoft, people coding on that system, people coding on the 360, would have had more space on the disk. They would have been able to utilize the format more. They would have been able to utilize the system more. They would have been able to utilize HD more. And also, honestly, I think if they went straight HD-DVD on the 360's internal disk drive, that piracy wouldn't have been as rampant. I really do think that. Because who has an HD-DVD burner? Who has blank HD-DVDs? Nobody. And even if the 360 did embrace that, yes, there would be some that'd be out, but it would still be relatively expensive. I mean, you could look at the PS3 right now. It's been out for, what, about 5-6 years? A Blu-ray burner is about $100. Blu-ray discs are about $1-$2 a piece. You know? You could get a good DVD burner for about $15-$20. And I get packs of, like, 50 packs of Memorex dual-layer DVDs for about $30, which isn't that bad. And single-layer DVDs, oh, those are cheap as hell. Single-layer DVDs, they're like, last time I bought them, which was about a year ago, I bought a 100-pack. That sustained me pretty well. But I paid $20 for a 100-pack, which is kind of pricey, I guess. But it was on sale, and it was right there. And I was like, I need DVDs now. I'll just get this. So, you know, about 20 cents a disc. Not bad. But that's really about it. As for... I mean, that's what I have to say about the systems, really. As for the actual games, though, now we're getting into something. Now, I have some stuff next to me, some examples that are good. Alright? Oh, what do I want to start with? I think I'll start with this. Gears of War 3. Good game. I liked it. Alright. I'd recommend playing this game. If you're a Gears fan or if you want to get into the series, I'd recommend it. It's a good game. The multiplayer is good. Single player is good. Co-op is awesome, as always. But why do I bring this up? Because I'm fucking sick of seeing Day 1 DLC. And why did I pick Gears specifically? Because this is probably one of the worst offenders of our generation. Not for Day 1 DLC, no, not that. But for selling you the actual game disc. So you're paying $60 for this right here. This is what you're paying $60 for, okay? But then, if you went home and you pop this in your system, and you go onto your dashboard, you see something. It says, Gears of War 3 Season Pass. Save money on the downloadable content by buying it all in one go. You'll get all this bonus stuff earlier than other people, and for cheaper, for a discounted rate. Now, if I remember right, this was about $40. So, I didn't buy it. I had no need to. I don't play Gears Online. I didn't really care. But many, many, many people bought it. They paid $40 for this. And the worst part was, it's not refundable. It's not. They made the Gears 2 Season Pass sound something like the L.A. Noire Season Pass. With L.A. Noire, you actually get downloadable content. You actually get new missions, new weapons, character outfits, all this other stuff. You actually physically download it onto your system. It's not on the discs. You'd have to download it from Microsoft servers. And you get a discounted rate on it. While is the Gear Season Pass? You pay about $40 for this little tiny, this little itty bitty file that's less than a megabyte. So you pay $40 for an unlock code. You pay $40 for something that you technically already paid for. Because you paid $60 for this. You pay $60 for the physical disc and the data, the unlock code that you're using, the thing that you paid $40 for on the marketplace is physically on your disc. You just paid $40 for a little code. Now, some of you who don't know about this at all, you might be asking, Mario, why are you going off about this? What is the Gears 3 Season Pass? Why is it such a big deal? You want to know what the Gears 3 Season Pass was? It was a bunch of weapon skins and character skins for multiplayer use that were already on your Gears of War 3 disc that you went out and paid $60 for. So, to utilize all the stuff on the disc, you're paying $100. I honestly wouldn't have had as much of an issue with it if you actually had to download the files. If you had to download a 1 gigabyte file full of all this stuff, I wouldn't have had as much of an issue. Yes, it would have been a ripoff for some skins. But you're actually paying for something that you're downloading. You're not paying for an unlock code. And there's been many, many, many other developers that are fully embracing this. That just love it. Capcom is one of the worst offenders. But getting back to this, Epic listens to their community. Epic loves their community. Cliffy B, that's what these Gears players know. Cliffy Blazinski, whatever his name is. They know him. They love him. They would suck his dick. He ripped you guys off with this. Yes, he did. Now, what did Epic say about it? Because the whole Gears community had an uproar. Now, what did they say about it? They said, we did it because of technical reasons. Because people are going to be using those skins in-game. But not everybody is going to buy the skins. So, if people who are playing online who have the skins already are playing with people who don't have them unlocked, there's going to be all these technical issues. There's going to be lag. There's going to be all this other stuff in your multiplayer matches. So that's why, for your protection, we put your downloadable content that you have to pay for normally online, we just conveniently put it on the disc for you. We put it on the disc, so all you have to do is pay $40 for a little tiny unlock code. Bullshit. Bullshit. What happened to the days where when you buy a game, you get everything on the game? Developers are locking away shit on here. They really are. Epic, like I said, one of the best developers out there, due to the fact they actually listen to their community, they raped their community with this. They sold you this game with DLC already on it physically. I don't know how much I can stress this. The downloadable content is on the disc. And you have to pay $40 for an unlock code. Putting that shit down. This is another pretty bad offender with it. Now, why is this a bad offender? Marvel vs. Capcom 3, Fate of Two Worlds. Now, I'm not going to get into specifics. I'm not a huge fighter fan. I bought this because it was like 15 bucks maybe. I liked it, okay? Now, there's going to be other people that are diehard Marvel vs. Capcom fans, fighter fans. They're going to say, oh yeah, it didn't have enough characters, blah, 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 blah. I'm not going to look at that. I'm not going to look at that. What I'm looking at is that Capcom shipped out a unfinished game. There are characters on here that, just like the Gears DLC, are locked away on the physical disc and that you have to pay for online to get an unlock code. There are characters on here that are incomplete. And if you use some hacks, you can actually play as them. And they're like 80-90% complete maybe, but they're incomplete. Technically, Capcom is selling you an incomplete game. So what do? They release Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3. Yeah. That's the problem with these developers. They're just all after the money now. I throw that down as well. Now, you know, I'm just going to get all my stuff here. Duke Nukem Forever. Game we've been waiting for a while. I didn't even beat this game. I'll be honest, I didn't beat it. Got like halfway through. You know why? Kind of makes me sad, honestly. This game people have been waiting for more than a decade. But it plays like a game that should have come out in 2004. If you've ever played Quake 4, it's a good game. But it came out in 2005. Now, I remember when I first got my 360, I thought Quake 4 was amazing. I thought it was a great game. I loved it. That actually got me back into first-person shooters. But we're in 2011 now. So why does this play the same as Quake 4? This game is pretty much Quake 4 with sex. Now, Quake 4 is a good game, but it hasn't aged that well. Now, when I pay for a game that has come out in 2011, in the year 2011, I expect it to play as a new game, as a nice, shiny, polished game. Like, okay, this might be, you know, this is a bad but good example. Now, aside from my little DLC rant, Gears 3 I thought was pretty good. Alright? I think we established this. This is a good game. Besides DLC, the developers knew what they were doing. This is not a good game. Diehard fans of the series didn't like it. Now why? It's slow. It's clunky. There's a fucking loading screen every 3 minutes. This loading screen is long. It's about a minute long. I installed the game to my hard drive. And the loading screen's like a minute. Why? Why? Why, Duke? Why? This is one of the most disappointing games you'll ever play. I'm tired of stuff like that, too. Oh, boy. I still got more examples to go through. Dead Island. Who do you voodoo, bitch? This is a good game. I like it. But, now, I wasn't one of those people who went out and bought it on day one. I just got it for Black Friday. But there were so many issues with this game. In short, one of my friends, who was really looking forward to it, bought it on day one. He said that the connections and everything else on the game was so glitchy. Saves were getting corrupted. Nobody could connect to each other. The first 3 days, he said this game was unplayable. He bought Space Marine and this game in the same day. He really wanted to play this. But he said that it was just so bad and so unplayable that he couldn't do anything with it. I don't know why they don't get their shit together. And that's another thing I'm tired of seeing. Developers look at the internet and downloadable content as a reason to ship out untested and unfinished games. You want some examples? Marvel vs. Capcom 3. Dead Island. What else is there? Alone in the Dark. That's a real good example. They're sending out these buggy-ass games. Just these terribly glitchy games. And I don't... Like, the PS2 days, the Xbox days, well, mainly the PS2, but it's like... If you release a game with a bunch of glitches, you can't do that. You have to test it. And this was something... I was pissed off about this. Before the game came out, I was looking at a bunch of developer QA sessions. One of the guys said who worked on this game, who originally worked on Duke Nukem 3D, said that every night before they went home, they would test play the whole Duke Nukem 3D game to make sure that they had a nice, shiny, polished product on store shelves by the time the game hit. What happened to that? That's true testing right there. What has happened? There's still people in the year 2011. Now, yes, maybe you need to say they need to upgrade, but there's people, they don't have internet. What about them? What about those people that when they buy a game, they can't update? That's a problem with this. Developers are using the internet as an excuse to ship out buggy and incomplete games to put on store shelves that you buy for $60, and all you have to do is download an update. That's it. Some other examples, anyways. Let's move on to this. I'm tired of this, too. Call of Duty? This has become a yearly thing. Fucking tired of it! Fucking tired of seeing these! Bullshit. This I paid like $10 for, but yeah. This is why I have it. I'm tired of Call of Duty becoming like a sports franchise. Just give it a fucking rest. That's it. I didn't like Modern Warfare 3, okay? I didn't like it. I thought it was stupid. I thought it was a $60 downloadable content pack for Modern Warfare 2. That's all there was. Now, there's people that say, oh yeah, it looks like Modern Warfare 2, but it plays like the first Modern Warfare. You know what the fuck I'm gonna do? I'm gonna put in my Call of Duty 4 disc, and I'm gonna be happy with that. That's what I'm going to do. I really want to play something that feels like Call of Duty 4. If I want to play something that looks like Modern Warfare 2, I'm going to play Modern Warfare 2 because it's cheaper and I thought it was a better game. And hold on, I actually need to get up and I need to get another game for another example. Here's another awesome game that somebody messed up on. Batman Arkham City. This is one of the best games that came out this year. Don't get me wrong, but I am sick and tired of this stuff right here. This is just retarded. Hold on. I did get a beta code, okay. I don't think I used that. Okay, hold on, sorry. This stuff. I'm sick and fucking tired of this, too. I don't really care about the code because I've already used it. But Day One, DLC again. And especially the downloadable content that you can only get by buying the game new. And that they say you can only get it when it first comes out. That's some bullshit. I'm tired of it. I really am. It's pissing me off. Because, in my opinion, if you complete some downloadable content before the game is even out, before the game is even mastered, and by mastered I mean they get the final image ready, they send it to the pressing factory, and they press it onto their discs. If you complete downloadable content before the game is out, it should be on the disc. Now I'm running out of a little time, but... Some examples that... here's one more bad example. PlayStation Move. I got this as a Christmas present from a friend. And I'm happy I did. Because I would not have paid for this. I really wouldn't have. There's no need for it, Sony! Why? Why? It sucks! It really does! For the money that you spend on a Move, you should honestly just get a Wii. You really should. That's it. Just get a nice used Wii for the same money that you're going to use to buy one of these. That's my opinion on it. But some examples. I'd like to end this on a nice note. Some examples that have actually gotten it right. Portal 2. Excellent game. And Valve always does a good job. Steam is amazing. But I'm not going to get into Steam because this is consoles, not PC. But they released some awesome free DLC on here. for all the community. That's how you do it. That's how you get customers. And Skyrim, awesome fucking game. Awesome game. Bethesda always does this stuff right. Game of the Year, I just had to mention that. This one of those companies actually does their stuff right. I'm nearing the end of my video. I'm running out of time. But that's my little rant. If you've watched this whole thing, thank you very much. But yeah. That's all I have to say. This generation sucks. That's it. But I'm still going to continue to play all my systems. Yes, even though they suck, I'll still be on Xbox Live. I'll still be on PSN watching my Blu-rays. Watching Netflix, all that stuff. That's all we can do. Y'all have a good day.